Welcome everyone, and welcome everyone. All praise and gentle glory to everyone and all future generations too, as we work to transmit the Dharma both to everyone here in the quote-unquote world at this time and to all future generations. So it's really important. The idea of the Dharma, it has to be transmitted to future generations too. It's not just for this generation, the generations that are here right now. It's really important to understand this. So I work for Longchenpa, who has designated me as one that he wants to help him transmit the Dharma to this generation, but also future generations. That's you know, that cannot be emphasized enough, that guess what? You know, 100 years, 200, 300, 400, 500, 600, 1,000, you know, we have to keep the Dharma strong. We want to transmit a very strong Dharma, the skillful means to liberate us from really the mental delusion that we have of doubt and continuity fear. Ultimately, I say is continuity fear. To evaporate the continuity fear, we need skillful means. Dharma might mean skillful means to evaporate continuity fear, which is the only problem any of us have that binds us to silliness, our loyalty to silliness. We're bound to it because of a familiarity issue. We're always biased against what we're not familiar with. There's a bias towards what we're familiar with. Be it ever so humble, there's no place like home. This is the bias that we have. And we all have severe bias. In Christianity, it says that we're all sinners, meaning we're severely biased against certainty, which is God. Okay, we're severely biased against it, otherwise we wouldn't be here. So we have to all be very humble and accept this fact. We're all severely biased, except for the rare Dharma Kings that come here. And there have been a few that have come here that have no bias at all against certainty. We can name a few. Manjushri, the primal Bodhisattva, apparently had everything to do with Gautama Buddha, okay, and then Padmasambhava in Tibetan Buddhism, and following on with Tibetan Buddhism, Longchenpa most certainly was free of all bias towards certainty. Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro, more recently in the 20th century, was liberated from bias against certainty. And then we have, of course, Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma, totally free of any bias. Immaculately free of any bias towards certainty. And our great, great friend Ramana Maharshi, also totally free of any bias towards certainty. So, and there are others throughout history. But other than them, we all have a bias. We all are biased in some way. Now, even if we awaken from delusion, there's still some residual biases going on. Okay, so we still have to remain humble. We still have to remain humble. It's very important to have a humble swagger. Okay. Not a vainglorious type of swagger. No. If we say we're enlightened, I say, yes, I'm a Dharma prince. I'm not enlightened, but Longchenpa said, I'm certainly going to be in the near viewpoint. Say it's not going to take that much longer, which I'm starting to see that is true, that is so. But even if you're enlightened, you must stay humble. You see some of the Tibetan Buddhists who are abiding in Rigpa, Guru Vision, intrinsic spaciousness, and they're still so gentle and so humble, you know, and just so beautiful in their humility. These are the examples that we should follow. Because there's still traces of bias, and they're aware of this. They're aware of this. It is said, like, to be a Buddha, you must cross the 10 bhumis, B-H-U-M-I, which are these various stages of even greater freedom from any bias whatsoever, really. And they really say it goes on and on and on until you just have to have just utterly amazing selflessness, you know, to be considered a Buddha, such as Manjushri, both a Buddha and a Bodhisattva. You could say certainly perhaps the primal bodhisattva, you know, the top bodhisattva, Manjushri, gentle glory. The name means gentle glory. And our style here is a style of gentle glory. So we're not going around being overly boastful. We tell it like it is, but stay humble. So the world set me free. The world, the people of the world, the spirit of the world set me free, which was just extraordinary. And why they trusted me. They said, go to the king and get help, please. We know you will do so. And I said, okay, I'll do so. And I'm doing so. And what's amazing also is that everybody trusts me. They help me out. They tip me off to stuff. Everyone I meet is helpful in some way. It's really amazing. But it's done subtly because they're too frightened. They're too frightened to do it any other way. It's just the way that grace has to play in the world. But I get it. More often than not, I pick up on it and I say, wow, fantastic. They're really, because everyone wants to be liberated from this dreadful mental affliction that we all suffer from here. This affliction of doubt, you might say. And so they're just saying, help, please help. And they're desperate. And I understand their desperation, having been through it all. So I am doing everything I can do to help transmit skillful means of practicing. It's so important to have skillful means of practicing. Now, the Holy Spirit wants me to do this video, and I don't really want to do it. Because it usually the Holy Spirit, the grace of God, asks me to speak in areas that nobody else will speak on. So it's like I'm always sticking my neck out, you know. I don't particularly enjoy that. I'd rather stay out of all that stuff. But the world is saying, hey, help, you know, say something. And a lot of times, I don't know how to say it. You know, it's like, wow, you want me to talk on this subject? Are you kidding me? So, I don't know what to say, really. But I've been tipped off recently. Some wonderful tipsters. They have different styles, you know. But I always try to look at people as the grace of God. Everyone that I meet they represent the grace of God, and they're here to help. We're here to help one another get free of dreadful mental affliction. And through the grace of God, I've been able to get glimpses of freedom and understand the skillful means to get more glimpses. And I had one this morning at 4 a.m. It was extremely profound. I was really desperate because I know trouble is coming, and I'm so desperate. And I got tremendous help. I was praying to Manjushri and Longchenpa. And as always, they came through for me in a tremendous way. I'm not going to get into that at this point. This video is on another topic. But maybe we'll blend that in. I don't know. But the freedom, the clarity is coming in larger and larger ways for me, which is great. It's also very shocking, and have to block the panic and full stop in the wow, do the wow practice, which is the central practice we have here, the skillful means, which is a very key skillful means. If we do just this one practice correctly, that's all we need to do. That's all we need to do, this one practice skillfully. And it's quite simple. We just, all conclusions, all definitions, all reactions, we just say all conclusions, everything concludes as wow. Okay, so all storylines conclude as wow. Since we know that, we're within our rights to simply practice the conclusion right now to whatever storyline arises, whatever question storyline arises, whatever doubt arises, the doubt is resolved as wow, ultimately it is, which is the final definition. before we go beyond all definitions, right? Before we drop all definitions. Ultimately, we're pure freedom, so there's no definition of what we are. But since we've been trying to define what we are, doubting ourselves, we're so used to definition, it's not pragmatically possible to drop all definition and abide as that here. So we keep one definition, just one definition. It's just wow. We are wow. Okay, we are wow. Everyone is wow. We're all wow. That's it. All of us. So without judging any of us in that light of that we're all equal, equally pure freedom. All of us, one spiritual family. There's just one spiritual family. I've experienced this. I've seen it. It is true. We're all perfect members of this one spiritual family with equal standing. Everyone has equal standing because we're all perfectly free. Nobody can impinge upon our freedom at all. But with saying that, I have to now bring up some topic that people might think, well, I'm being disparaging about this person or that person, etc. But the context here is gentle glory, total forgiveness for everyone. There's nothing to forgive. We're all perfect, okay? We're all perfect. We're all equal. And all love one another totally, actually. So there's no intent to disparage. What I need to do is I need to sort of give a heads up to everybody that we're headed towards a very bumpy ride here in the world. And the more you're clued into this, the easier it'll go for you. The easier it'll go for you. So, a couple days from now, probably 3 days. I mean, you're seeing this Tuesday, so Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, then after 3 days, Donald Trump is going to be inaugurated as the President of the United States. Okay, he'll be President Trump at that time. So, I haven't really been speaking, I've been avoiding this issue because I've been focused on what I needed to focus on. But I've gotten tipped off recently that I need to speak up a little bit here and throw some light on the whole situation. Now, some are Trump supporters, some are Trump detractors, etc. So I don't want to, you know, bother anybody either way. But we need to have our eyes open. Okay, we need to be open-eyed about what's going on. Now, in the past, I said, well, you know, Trump was the lesser of two evils, and I still believe that. I believe that. That doesn't mean I'm saying he's not problematical. He most certainly is problematical. Okay, to a large extent, actually, but it's just one side of the coin. It's bigger than him. He's not. It's a trap that's been set in this world, and I'm not going to get into that trap too much here because that goes beyond people's understanding to most part, because it involves, it's a cosmic sort of situation going on here. It's a cosmic trap that's been set for this planet, and he's just one of the players that's involved in sort of springing the trap, you might say. But it goes beyond that. So don't blame Trump for everything, okay? Let's not get into the blame game, but let's be aware of what's going on. And I was tipped off to something, and I did a video quite some years back that I just felt, you know, I needed to get this off my chest and say, hey, you know, it's time for us to say what happened back in the 80s and 90s. It was about Da Free John, Da Lovananda, Bubba Free John, Frank Jones was his name. This very charismatic and also very erratic and highly problematical self-proclaimed greatest guru of all time, God, self-proclaimed God. He proclaimed he was God. And I just said, you know, it's time for us to kind of put this to rest and let's move on. Let's move on. So we've moved on. But I had, you know, a tremendous amount of focus in the late 70s, I believe, in the 80s, or maybe even the earlier early 70s. I can't exactly remember, but I really had a lot of people had a lot of hope in him, because America was looking for a great spiritual leader, and he said, "I'm here. I'm the one you've been waiting for." And so he just absolutely came on so strong. So strong, and really knocked so many people out. He was a real knockout artist. And fortunately, I was saved from this. That's a long story. The Holy Spirit saved me. But I certainly was close enough to really be tuned into the whole vibe of the situation. And he really became very erratic and problematic as he went on in later years. But initially, I mean, we thought, wow, this is just amazing. God, you know, we finally have this awesome guru and is the greatest ever. And, you know, it knocked a lot of people out. It really knocked them out. He was a knockout artist. Came on strong up front. Okay. But behind, the deeper down, he had some very, very severely flawed. He was very severely flawed. He said he was the reincarnation, basically, of Swami Vivekananda, who was also deeply flawed by his own admission. So spiritual egotist. He was a spiritual, Geoffrey John's a spiritual megalomaniac, very grandiose. He had very bad flaws. But he could certainly paint a pretty picture of himself. Okay. I noticed something. Hey, wait a minute. So people started commenting on this video. They haven't commented before, and suddenly I'm getting a bunch of comments. I said, why the heck are people commenting on this? That's so odd. I've basically forgotten all about it. And then suddenly I realized that Geoffrey John, his grandiose style is extremely similar to Donald Trump's style. Extremely similar. The braggadocio, like, I'm so great. I'm the greatest thing there's ever been. I mean, but Geoffrey John did it in a spiritual context. Donald Trump does it in a political context. I said, holy cow, they have very similar personalities, actually. And I know both of them. I know both of their personalities. I just hadn't seen that how similar they are. I hadn't thought to correlate them. And then it just clicked, obviously. So, oh, my gosh. You know, they have very, very similar personalities. The way, the boastfulness, you know, talk about just how awesome everything they do is, and they're the greatest thing since sliced bread, and they're going to fix this and this and this and do this and this. And just the whole package is very similar, actually. I said, huh. Yeah, that's true. And then something else clicked in me that's really quite astonishing. Okay, quite astonishing. They both grew up in the same town. They both grew up in the same town, Jamaica, New York. Jamaica, New York. Frank Jones, November 3rd, 1939, Jamaica, New York. Donald Trump, June 14th or something like that? 1940, what is it? 46? Something like that, right? Or is it 47? I don't know. But yeah, there's a span of about 6 or 7 years difference. But both born and grew up in Jamaica, Queens, basically, New York, right? May have been born in the same hospital, actually. And I said, oh my gosh. What are the odds of that? What are the odds? It's like, hey, wait a minute. You know, this is a super attention getter. A super attention getter. So I said, uh-oh. Because, again, now, there's another thing. I was talking to this very wise Christian. And Christians have a certain type of wisdom. You know, I mean, people have been up and down, for pro, con, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, you can disparage Christians in various ways, but there's a side of Christianity that's quite wise, actually. Okay. And Christians tend to be quite wise about certain cosmological factors. The picture that Christians have is a slightly different picture than other religions. And They certainly are wise about the end times, okay? Apocalyptic times, end times, return of Jesus. Why, you know, people go astray? What is sort of the bigger picture of St. Paul said we struggle not with powers and principalities of this world, but powers and principalities in the high heavens, meaning subtler realms, subtler other dimensions, etc. The Christians are very aware of this. They're very aware of how the end times are going to play out, and so he one day he mentioned to me, because we are really, you know, saying we hope Hillary doesn't get elected, because that's going to be really severe spiritually, from a spiritual standpoint, very severe problem for the world. And but then he said, well, you know, yeah, but that's true, but he says, you know, Trump might be the Antichrist. And I said, what? I said, wow. Because why did he say that? You know, this is someone that generally speaks very wisely. And I said, wow. And so I just kept an open mind. I said, well, you know, I don't know. But I've talked about some of the things that I've seen. The grandiosity of his personality is extreme, actually, quite extreme. You know, the Trump Towers, the pomp and grandiosity is just over the top. Now, you know, I'd say, well, there's an element of New York in that, because New Yorkers tend to be overconfident. Well, they are. Or New Yorkers suffer from an affliction of overconfidence. That is very true. But not to the extent of Trump. Okay, this is something different. This is something different. He has it, you know, to an extreme extent. A vainglorious sort of personality, right? And, you know, I was thinking, well, maybe all that bombast he has about how great he is, it's just a New York shtick, you know. But if you look at his lifestyle and everything like that, you know, maybe he believes it. Maybe he believes he really is super great. You know, we hope not. We hope it's just a put-on, right? But maybe it's not. Maybe it's not. I mean, all these gilded towers that he builds and the way he, you know, presents everything has to be the best. He always says, I'm the best. It has to be the best at everything. And putting himself up there, you know, as just the ultimate top best. And this is more than just New York's street shtick, you know, I would say. So we don't want to be too quick to just excuse it in that way. It's just a style of you know, New York. No, I don't think. I think it's something else. So then, you know, and I talked to this Christian, and other Christians also kind of like, but this one Christian is saying, like, you know, if you look at it, he could be the Antichrist. And I said, well, you know, I mean, it's possible, isn't it? It's possible because the Antichrist is supposed to come in, and things are supposed to be in a mess, and this political leader, supposed to be a great political leader, is supposed to just fix everything really fast, really, really fast. Economy, all these problems, you know, seem to like vanish, and then people say he's like unbelievable wonder worker, and then at some point he's going to proclaim himself God, apparently, you know, which is exactly what Joffrey John did, okay. And I'm saying that they have the same personality, born probably in the same hospital in Jamaica, Queens, New York, coming from the exact same geographical area, with extremely similar personalities. And Joffrey John started out as this, you know, super uber guru, like he was just unbelievably erudite and brilliant. And ultimately, he proclaimed himself God. And became extremely problematical. So, you know, is it possible that Trump may start, well, Joffrey John started out as very charismatic, okay, very charismatic, very brilliant. And we said, oh my gosh, maybe he's going to be able to really solve our spiritual problems. And he said, yes, I will. I'm absolutely here to do that. No question about it. And I'm going to do that. I mean, no one has ever come on as strong as he did. In spiritual history, no one has ever come on that strong. He came on like, I am the ultimate, ultimate guru, and I am here to you know, set you free and bring you to enlightenment, and it's a done deal. It was just, you know, astonishing bombast, really. Just astonishing. But when you're being hit by it back then, you know, it was just very potent stuff. You know, we're these little spiritual peons, you know, and he's hitting with this stuff. Is I'm here to save you. All you got to do is join my, join devotion of me, and it's going to happen for you. And the way he presented it was so over the top, so confident and boastful and braggadocio, that it was extremely difficult to resist. So Trump is saying, you know, similar, you know, braggadocio and confidence, just confidence, which, you know, is just almost ridiculous, that he's going to solve this, the boom is done, you know, I'm just going to set everything right. Well, the thing is that initially, like the correlation to Daffrey John, initially, you know, he just was a whirlwind and created this massive buzz, really spiritual buzz. It was just like he was everywhere. He was, you know, and people are saying, wow, maybe this is it. Maybe this is it. I even said, hey, maybe this is it. But also I said, huh, you know, I'm not, you know, this is, what is going on here? I wasn't completely sold. And then I actually had some meetings with him in the subtle levels, spiritual levels. And those didn't go well at all. They went very badly, actually. And I said, wow, that's scary. This guy's scary, actually. He wasn't the at all what I knew to be a genuine guru. Okay, his flaws were revealed in the subtle plane where I met him spiritually. I said, uh-oh, this guy's a real molester, you know, spiritual molester, actually. Very troublesome. So I veered away from it. I was able to veer away from it, fortunately. Thank God for that. Now, with Trump, it's like a lot of people are saying, huh, you know, this guy's really promising us the world, isn't he? And don't think that he can't get a lot done. I mean, if you look at his style, He can come on really strong, really strong, and he may very well get everyone's heads in a whirl, you know, just like, oh my gosh, all these problems that we've had, and God knows the liberals have botched things so terribly that we are in drastic trouble right now in the United States and in the world in general, drastic trouble. Which is the reason why Trump got elected, because the liberals screwed up so badly. They're just, you know, drastically overconfident, don't know what they're talking about, don't know what they're doing, they're clueless. They're really clueless. They're just vague, nebulous idealists, you know, who just, you know, have no business really running the world at all. So this has left the door wide open for Trump to come in, this style, because people are so desperate. People are so desperate. And Daffrey John Siller, we were so desperate at the time because Christianity was collapsing. We had some troubles with erratic gurus, and we were desperate for some spiritual leader to appear to pull us out of our confusion, spiritual confusion. We were very spiritually confused in coming out of the 60s, and we were so desperate. We heard about the great gurus of the East, Ram Maharshi, but he passed on, Sri Sri Anandamayi, but it's hard to find her. And, you know, we just say, please, we need help, we're desperate. And then he burst on the scene and says, I'm the one you've been waiting for, you know. I'm the one, the promised return of, you know, just on and on and on and on. I mean, he never ran out of superlatives to describe himself. So I'm not going to try to go over all of them. But he always came up with a new one, you know, to trump the last one that he had. You know, like, I'm even better than that. Here it is. You know. And it's just amazing. His self-promotion never ended. Well, isn't Trump the ultimate in self-promotion also? Is it right? I mean, he never seems to run out of bluster for self-promotion. So again, we have this amazing similarity of personalities coming from Jamaica, Queens, New York. Astonishing, astonishing. So just let this kind of sink in and say, uh-oh. So the style that might be, is what I'm seeing, is that it could very well be that he may just do amazing wonders the first year. So I mean, starting out, he may just start like a ball on fire. Just like a ball on fire. This is their style. And this, it's front-loaded style, you know. It's front-loaded style to cover up the deficiencies. The deficiencies. And obviously, he has a lot of deficiencies. Trump does. Okay. Not that he's a bad guy, but when you get someone like that in, as the most powerful person in the world, that can go to your head. And you know, they say absolute power corrupts absolutely, right? At least politically we say that. And sometimes spiritually, if you're not truly humble, if you're not truly grounded. And so you get enough devotees telling you, yeah, you are God, then you start going really cuckoo. Okay, so Trev may start out really great, but people might start saying, oh my God, this guy's like a political messiah. I mean, he's just like a godsend, you know, and this may very well go to his head. It may very well go to his head. So this is a very dangerous dynamic where you get the type of personality that Joffrey John and Donald J. Trump have. And they get too many people telling them that, hey, you really are God, then they really go cuckoo. And they just believe their own marketing shtick. They believe it. They end up believing their own, you know, their grandiosity. And they can't find their way out of it. And then big troubles come along. Big troubles come along. So Holy Spirit has told me is to take 217 off, go take refuge, and not pay any attention to what's going on. It's very important. It's very important. So I already don't pay any attention to the news. So it's easy for me. I'm not going to pay any attention to what Trump does his first year. I know people will be blabbing about it all the time, but so I have to remove myself to some place, somehow get into such a situation where I'm really isolated from it. And I highly urge everybody, do not buy into it, okay? This is a potentially very problematical individual because of the overall dynamics of the situation in the world. Again, I've been around him, and I would play golf with him. I mean, I would pal around, joke with him. I mean, he's not, you know, an evil sort, okay? But he's a dangerous sort. There's sort of a difference there, but sometimes though the ones that are kind of very personable but have this, you know, certain personality situation, grandiosity, they can be very dangerous actually, ultimately, and things can go awry, very much so awry. The wheels come off at some point badly, and then a lot of people get really burned. A lot of people that thought Joffrey John was the greatest thing ever, you know, really got burned badly. I got burned by him badly. Still, you know, recovering. I'm recovering from that still. Mostly recovered, but I consider myself still recovering. I probably all, you know, this lifetime I'll always have to be cautious. Because he had such a blustery style that it's quite misleading and dangerous, and plays on our hope. It plays on our hopes. You know, the more hopeless we are, the more difficulty we have. So now I have a real hope, so it doesn't bother me so much. But I keep away from him for sure. I just stay away. I don't want to have anything to do with him, still at this point, that is for sure. And so, a lot of people really got badly, badly bummed out by the situation. And they have to look in the mirror and say, why did you buy into it? You know, you were part of the problem. We all were part of the problem to some extent. We always are. We get what we deserve. And so, you know, maybe a lot of his devotees, they themselves wanted to be, you know, greater than everybody else, right? And so it was an ego trip. It was a spiritual ego trip is what it really was. It was maybe the greatest spiritual ego trip in history, but still a spiritual ego trip nonetheless. And that never gets the job done, okay? And it ends up, you know, really being painful, really. So be very careful about the Trump train. Be very careful about the Trump train. And just, you know, maybe some people won't sit it out and they may end up getting, you know, buyer's regrets in a very bad way at some point. This is what's being, I'm being tipped off about this. And again, not that I dislike him, not that I dislike Dafri John to start out with, but you know, but I realize, oh my gosh, you know, this guy is going to lead me to ruination, you know, spiritual ruination, and I don't want to go there. So dangerous character. So again, Trump, I don't dislike the person, but he could be a very dangerous character. However, it's in front of us to the extent. Now, here's one thing about Dafri John is I really look in hindsight, I have to say, you know, he was a blessing in disguise because I had to work so hard my entire life to get free of his influence, to make sure, you know, that I ended up having to push myself just to an extreme extent to get past that charismatic front, you know, of spirituality and get into real deeper truths and really see for myself what is true. So he really pushed me. Not again, not that maybe that was what he wanted to do, but it ended up, I made lemonade out of it. You know, it was a very sour lemon, but I made lemonade, great lemonade out of it. Without someone like that, I don't think I would have been pushed nearly as much. It was sort of like, you know, the devil was after me. And if I didn't run really, really fast, he was going to get me. So I've had to run really, really fast. So I thank him for that. And I hope that he understands, you know, that it was a blessing in disguise for me. It really was. It really was. But he put me really through a great deal of worry and concern, actually. It was very traumatic. So Trump may be a blessing in disguise for the world too, but also very traumatic for many. Because I think what's going to happen is that many people, after they go through what's going to happen with Trump, is they're going to turn to genuine spirituality and say, hey, you know what? That's enough of politics. This is, we can't trust it. We just cannot trust it anymore. And they're going to try to become Dharmic, which is where we get to now. Dharmic culture. I am Dharmic. Wangchenpa has made me Dharmic. He's officially recognized me. I am officially Dharmic, a part of Dharmic culture, which is again part of transmitting skillful means to throughout the world into future generations to come, and making sure the flow of this great river of clarity and certainty reaches, you know, everybody. And for instance, in India, you know, the class of Brahmins is a Dharmic class. At least that's what set up, Vedic culture set that up. So that's the highest class in this world, is the Dharmic class. Those who are Dharmic are the highest class. And it is true, as Jesus said, the least in the kingdom of heaven are greater than the greatest who are not in the kingdom of heaven. And there's a parallel with Dharmic culture, a very strong parallel, in that if you're part of Dharmic culture, you're higher than anyone who is not part of Dharmic culture. I don't care if they're the President of the United States. You are much, way, way higher, okay, in class than they are. You totally trump them, totally. So I'm not afraid of Trump. For me, he's not Dharmic, okay? He's not part of Dharmic culture. And neither was Obama. The presidents, people in politics are generally not part of Dharmic culture. Someone in Dharmic culture would not pursue a political career, okay? That's just out of the question, really. For almost, you know, maybe some rare exceptions, but it's pretty much out of the question. They have way better things to do than that. Way better. So it's a blessing for me to be part of Dharmic culture and to be able to speak about this. I can speak about this because I'm speaking about a situation that I'm way above that. And you know, I can say, you know, I could, you know, they're like, I can admonish them. I have the right to admonish them. People, those of us in Dharmic culture, have every right to admonish and advise. Admonish and advise. That's our role. And so we're pointing out, hey, okay, this needs to be looked at very, very wisely and carefully, what's going on in the world right now. The trap we face is really the crashing of our expectations. It's a trap from many angles, actually. But what's happened is we built up all these absurd expectations for our future. The liberals, the progressives have done that. And now all of that's going to change very quickly. It's like the wall is going to come crashing down, and we're going to see a very different future. And this is going to... When you have your expectations for your future, that you believe that's your life, this is what's going to be the future of this world for your children, your grandchildren, for you, for everyone, and they think this is life. We know what life is supposed to be like, and that all comes crashing down very quickly. You go into severe shock, which has happened since the election of Trump. The liberals and progressives are in severe shock. But if you understand how the mind works, shock then progresses. If it's not stopped right there and you allow it to settle through skillful dharmic means and practice, it turns into panic. So what's going to happen when Trump starts just changing, pushing all these buttons, boom, 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 the whole progressive agenda may just evaporate, vanish like a mirage. And at that point, they're going to go into panic. And when you go into panic, what happens is you become extremely prone to rage and anger, very great anger and rage. And guess who is aware of this? The activists. The activists are very aware of this. So there's this whole group of people called activists. They're part of this trap also. And ultimately, to show you where we're going towards, the whole purpose of this trap that's been set in this world is to destroy Dharmic culture. That is their purpose. They do not want it transmitted to future generations. They do not. They want to stop it right here and end it. So they've set this very diabolical trap in this world to crash expectations and drive people into panic, and then into severe, the activists will whip up severe anger. The demagogue activists will push that panic into anger, rage. And then they'll say, hey, you're really angry, but I have a way to make you... And people feel guilty when they're enraged, right? They say, oh, something's wrong with me. The activists come along and they say, hey, you're really angry, but you know what? If you just channel that anger into this self-righteous cause that I'm fronting for, you'd be a wonderful, righteous person. You don't need to feel guilty anymore about your anger because it's righteous anger. And people are suckers for this, okay? These are the wolves in sheep's clothing. Activists are wolves in sheep's clothing, actually. They're not dharmic at all, okay? Jesus severely chastised these people, okay? Severely, and told us, look out. These are the most dangerous people. Activists, social activists are the most dangerous people. The do-gooders are the most dangerous people in the world, actually. Because they're the ones who, once, Trump crashes the expectations that the liberal progressives built up, panic sets, shock, and then panic, and then anger. They pounce on you and say, hey, you're feeling really guilty, aren't you? Well, I'll tell you what, if you get into this self-righteous cause, this activist cause, you won't feel guilty anymore. And so you get into that, and suddenly you're being love-bombed, like, what a great person you are. You're saving the world, and it seems like the anger now is in the right direction, so you don't feel so guilty anymore. You think, well, it's justified. It's justified anger. So they give you a justification for your anger, which is really justifying your panic. And it's a whole non-dharmic cycle. Now, what happens then is that when you get a glimpse of clarity, which is within all of us, and these glimpses happen to us all the time, little ones. We hardly remember them, but they happen to all of us, actually. And we say, hey, say, wait a minute. You say, the shock wears off. You suddenly come out of panic for a moment, right? And you suddenly see, oh my gosh, I've been, things are not the way I thought they were in my panic state of mind. And then you lose your anger. You say, oh, I'm not so threatened. Everything's okay, going to be okay. And your anger stops. Well, when that happens, of course, you lose your motivation that you were using, that the rage, fear and rage, that was channeled into the self-righteous activist cause. You start to drop out of the activist cause. At that point, what do the activists do? The activists then say, hey, you know, you seem like you're losing your motivation. What's wrong? And then you'll say, I kind of glimpsed God. God kind of spoke to me. I saw a glimpse of truth, and I realized, wow, I'm okay. It's all okay. God loves me. God loves everyone just the way we are. Everything's okay. And then the activists will say, but you know, does that mean you're leaving? So, well, yeah, I don't quite feel the way I used to. And they say, well, you know, you're not part of the problem, because this cause is so important. It's going to save the world. It's going to save so many problems. You know, starving people here, and this on and on and on, right? Whatever it is, and you're not doing that anymore. Therefore, you're not righteous anymore. You become part of the problem. You're an evil one now. And then this creates a tremendous conflict in the mind of those trying to lead this activist cult. It's really a cult. Activism is really a cult. And you feel very guilty and conflicted between what you saw clearly of forgiveness from God, or that you're perfect. Everything's perfect, actually. And then we say, wait a minute. And the activists are saying everything's horrible and I'm supposed to fix it. And you become very conflicted. And then the activists, then what they do is they try to convince you that this glimpse of God removed your motivation to be good. And therefore God is really bad, because God removed your motivation to be good. You get this? So ultimately the goal of the activist is to convince you that God is actually evil, because God is removing your motivation to be good, to do good. This is their goal. The whole goal of this trap is to convince you that God is evil. Okay, that's the goal. And now, I can speak this way because having gone through the most activist time in history, and I've learned all these lessons of how it works, I said, it was nasty business, let me tell you. The 60s, okay, in the early 70s, the social revolutions that took place were just nasty business. And the guilt trips that we went through, it's a miracle that I survived. I really didn't survive. God just somehow resurrected me from the dead, really. That's all I can say, because I didn't survive it. It was brutal, brutal business. And that the 60s, that was a trial run for these times right now. It was actually a trial run to see, okay, how's this going to work, and how's the trap going to work. And so there's so many people now who are ready to spring this trap in a much greater way because of social media. Things are so different now that panic can spread throughout the world, rage in almost instantly, in a day or two. It's very different. Back in history, you go back far enough before, you know, media, it was even electronic media was even present, and even newspapers. There could be stuff going on in the world that everything was isolated. Nobody else in the world knew what was going on. So you couldn't spread global rage or panic or righteousness. Now you can spread righteousness, do good righteousness, self-righteousness. You could spread it around the entire planet and infect just, you know, almost everyone on the planet. Just like that, one tweet, you know, boom, right? It's that quick. It's that quick. So the problem we face now is infinitely more severe than previously. Even more, infinitely more severe than the 60s, actually. The mood, and I can read the world easily now, and the mood is headed in that direction 100%. The self-righteousness is you can feel it's just surging, ready to surge. And that's, Jesus said, don't call me good. That's the worst thing you can call me. I'm not a self-righteous Pharisee or Sadducee, which he condemned most severely. So this is the trap that's been set in this world. It's to stop the Dharma in its tracks, prevent it from being transmitted to future generations. That's the whole purpose of it. Well, who's behind this? Well, there are some folks behind this, believe me, who want this planet to be in a certain way in the future so they can exploit it the way they want to exploit it. And Dharma gets in their way. They've been prevented from doing this because of the Dharma. They can't stand it. They can't stand the Dharma. It freaks them out, and they can't live here. If there's Dharma is being transmitted in this world, they feel so uncomfortable they can't actually live here. So they want to make this world their living place, and so in order to do that, they feel they have to destroy the Dharma, and in order to do that, they have to stop the transmission of it to future generations. And they started out by trying to break up the family unit, attack, you know, turn children against the parents. They wanted to have like 3 or 4 generations of non-dharmic transmission in the world, which they've already accomplished that. I think what do they say? The communists, the socialists said, you know, give me 3 or 4 generations and they'll completely forget about the past. I can train them to be perfect, you know, little robots. Well, this is how it works. If you go through 3 or 4 generations with no transmission, it pretty much just dries up. But of course, it can always spring back. Because within us, the truth within us, it can always spring back to life, be resurrected at any moment. But it's not a good thing to block the transmission this way. So what they did was they attacked the family unit, tried to introduce feminism, get out, and women got to work, leave the home, use the television, the babysitter, they use the content on television, the information, entertainment, media complex, they use that to brainwash the generation, young children in a very deviant, decadent way, away from the Dharma. And through the music, through the movies, through the television shows, through the popular culture, all this stuff. Basically, the mothers weren't around to police their children away from that stuff like they had been before. And so they were wide open to it. And so they've had like about 3 generations, going on 4 now, of this. The boomers started it. And it's worked. It's worked for them. It's worked for them. People are so depraved now, so decadent, so pulled down to darkness. It's just astonishing, actually, how effective it's been. So they're very non-dharmic. They have no even clue there's such a thing now. Most people are clueless. I grew up in a dharmic household. My dad was dharmic, and he blocked all that stuff in the house. He blocked it all. Thank God for that, and much honor to him. No doubt about it. But most households, it wasn't blocked. It wasn't blocked. I was like, I think the only person in school didn't have a television. There's one other person, a Jewish family, I believe, they didn't have a television either. Because some Jews are dharmic. Also, they've tried to keep that alive. Is, hey, you don't allow this stuff in your culture. Okay, you don't allow this stuff in your culture. Now, you know, Jesus point, some Jews were dharmic and some weren't, just like any culture, right? But there's in various cultures, there's a part of high society of that is dharmic, and they are very careful about what's allowed in their house, what's allowed their children, what they're allowed to pay attention to. Very careful. But everybody else had televisions. And we're very much into comic books. We weren't allowed comic books, magazines, newspapers, television. We got a Christian Science Monitor as a weekly, I think weekly, newspaper, and that's it. Then we had all these, you know, we're allowed National Geographic and all these educational high kind of publications we had, and then books. So we had a beautiful library of all the great spiritual books in the house, and so I was raised in a very dharmic way. And I took to it like a duck takes to water. I just immediately plunged into it, because I knew that I had to be, you know, help the Dharma out, help transmit it at some, you know, some point. I'd have responsibilities. So, but even then, it was brutal. But most succumbed to it, and you know, the children now, you know, legal drugs and stuff. That's all part of blocking the transmission of the Dharma. If someone told me pot is legal in California, I don't know. I don't pay attention to any of that stuff so much, but that's what they say. It's like, huh, yeah, well, big surprise, huh? That's what it ends up being is drugs are extremely bad for the Dharma, extremely bad. Gives a very false sense of confidence. Terrible, wrong sense of, you lose your discipline because it tweaks your perception in such a way as you think, oh, I'm already dharmic, you know, and they think it's that easy like that, and they get lazy. It induces tremendous laziness in people, spiritual laziness, which is extremely anti-dharmic. So the trap is set. People are oblivious to what the Dharma is and how to transmit it, what needs to be done. And yet they have all these expectations for a great future, which you know, for many people, the plug's going to be pulled, and they think the world is coming to an end, and they're going to panic. The net result of all this panic, all this anger, all this social activism, all this stuff, it takes your attention away from the Dharma most severely. It severely blocks it, as it were. Your attention is off the Dharma. Because the spirituality of today is not Dharmic at all, most of it is not Dharmic at all. It's actually just clever dualism, very clever dualism. They don't know what they're talking about, actually. They really don't. They really don't. Dharma means the truth. I mean, Buddha brought the Dharma here to this world, for instance. Jesus brought the Dharma. They brought the truth. And the truth is something very different than what the world is teaching now spiritually and religiously. Even people who trumpet, you know, their non-dualness, no, it's very different than what they're saying. Not all. Some are teaching dharmically. There is still Dharma being taught in the world. But it's even that has been watered down, actually. Watered down quite a bit. It's not really strong transmission. It's not a strong transmission. And I don't think it's strong enough, quite frankly, to really get through to future generations. You really have to speak the adamant truth here so people realize, hey, there is an alternative viewpoint. There is an alternative viewpoint that is that completely different. That's the real Dharma. That's the real Dharma. And since I speak that way, Longchenpa asked me to help transmit the Dharma because I'm willing to speak that way. Very adamant, very, very adamant about what it really is. And it's quite different than what most spiritual people suppose it to be. And of course, most people think you don't know what you're talking about. Is that not many people listen, which is a difficulty. It's not easy when not many people are listening. That's for sure. They don't understand. What are you talking about? And and the Dharma, as Longchenpa said, has to be explained in a very clear explanation. Very adamant, very clear. That is the Dharma. If it's watered down, it's not Dharma. According to Longchenpa, it's really not Dharma. So Longchenpa himself brought my attention to this wonderful poem he wrote, Song of the Enchanting Wildwoods, that is really not well known at all. I never come across it, and I don't think many others have come across it. It was recently translated, and it's just the most brilliant piece of poetry I've ever read. And this was just very recently brought to my attention and translated. And what he says, he basically describes the current situation in the world to a T. It's exactly what he describes. And he says, when situations are like this, you must retreat. The Dharma must retreat and keep itself strong and viable for future generations when things calm down. And don't try to butt your head against the wall. Don't try to hit your head against the wall. There are times when the Dharma has to take a step back, half step back, so it can take a leap forward when at the opportune moment. So clearly he was giving me this advice that this is what you need to do, and I've had very clear advice about this, that it's time to take refuge. The Dharma needs to take refuge so it's not crushed, because the goal of this trap in the world is to wipe out the Dharma totally. Totally. Like King Herod's goal was, you know, to wipe it out, and so he heard that Jesus was born. He said, uh-oh, someone, this extreme Dharma king has been born, and I don't want that. So, you know, he apparently wanted, you know, tried to kill all children under the age of two years old and younger, thinking if he did that, Jesus would also be killed. But Jesus, as is said in the gospel, they were aware of this and fled. They were able to flee that and avoid it. That's went down to Egypt. Okay, so this is a very clear indication of what you do when times become extremely non-dharmic and there are attempts to wipe out the Dharma. You take refuge in some other place. Okay, Jesus going down to Egypt, where he was protected down there from Herod and what was going on. Okay, so that's really important. Really important. And he was like a child then. And many of us like are like spiritual children, like being a Dharma prince, it's still like a spiritual child. You know, I have a long, long ways to go. I'm still very biased against certainty. Long ways to go. I'm like a spiritual child, even though I'm Dharmic. I'm still very vulnerable. So, fleeing somewhere, you know, take refuge somewhere, it is the wise thing to do. When the wolves are you know, ravenously prowling about. And that's just a common metaphor. Well, I don't, you know, I'm not trying to disparage wolves. Some people love wolves so much they get very upset. What are you talking about? They're such wonderful creatures. Well, we're talking about a spiritual metaphor, what wolves do to sheep. Okay, we know what they do. I mean, wolves are very cunning predators, okay, hunting in packs. They're tremendously vicious in terms of being able to get their prey. Okay, I mean, they're very successful at that. Okay, so that's kind of what it means. Wolves are very cunning and successful at getting their prey. So we, being Dharmic, don't want to be fall prey to those who want to crush the Dharma, the transmission of the Dharma. Now, some of you might be saying, well, is it possible that this trap has been set in a cosmic way by other dimensions and other principalities and powers and principalities in other dimensions from other places in the universe, etc.? Yeah, of course, it's very possible. Yeah, I don't want to go into detail about it, but yeah, if you think that way, that you're probably thinking in the right direction, right? Yeah, just a hint there. It's multidimensional. It involves a lot that is not just of this world. Okay, and this world is a place that wants to, that they want to use to pursue other places. Okay, put it that way. And so planet Earth is a sort of a very helpful, it's very helpfully positioned. It's an important place so that if you want to do certain things in certain ways in other places, it's a very strategic, helpful place to have control over. So again, they can't stand the Dharma and they stay away. It's like kryptonite to them. Okay, the Dharma, just consider like it's like kryptonite, and they have to stay away from it. It saps them of their power. Why? Because the Dharma takes us out of anger and panic. It teaches us how to block panic. And those who have set this trap, their whole thing is to feed off panic, because panic creates anger, fear, anger, lust, all these kind of emotions that they feed off of, actually. They feed off of it. It's something that they it's an energy source that they use, actually. So they want everyone in the world to be very, very non-dharmic, and this empowers them. They feel they get power out of this, tremendous power out of it. Whereas the Dharma helps teach a skillful means of how to block panic. Okay, and when you know how to block panic, you start to become more and more calm, more and more gentle. You don't react. I was assaulted by three huge dogs recently. I've been assaulted in numerous ways recently, and there's really not been even a ripple of reaction from me, which quite shocked the people that were looking for that. They thought they could, you know, my heart would be pumping and I'd be freaking out. One of the people I was with did freak out that way, and they love that because they feed off it. They feed off it. And how this is possible? Well, in a dream, anything's possible, right? The really conditioned existence is actually just a mental projection, a dream. It's just a dream of doubt. Doubt doesn't have any cause at all in reality. It's causeless. We just choose to doubt. That's all. It's just a choice. It's not caused by anything in reality at all. It's just a choice. And when we choose that, then we go into this dreamlike state. And in this dreamlike state, we can. It's so weird. You know, this dream is so weird of conditioned existence. There's so much weirdness, I don't bother even trying to explain it. And we shouldn't put too much attention on that, because it'll waste your life. Because it's just, the rabbit hole never comes to an end, actually. But suffice it to say that there are those who driving people into panic is their stock and trade. That's their survival, as they see it, as a dream characters. That's how they learn, try to love doubt. They try to love doubt through others' panic. getting them to stay in a state of panic and anger and lust, and like a beast, you know, like a wild, like, so everyone, that's why all the movies and entertainment, so much of it is this bloodlust kind of attack, and you know, it's all that is designed to keep you in this state of high fear. Okay, fear. They live off of it. At least that's what they're imagining. It's all just a play of imagination. It's like it's a dream. It's got no reality to it at all, really. In terms of factualness of what's going on in a dream, it's just make-believe. Nothing's happening. Nothing's happening at all, actually. It's just pretense. So we're not going to, you know, chase anything down the rabbit hole, okay? We're just going to be very skillful in blocking panic. That's very dharmic, okay? And as you block panic by letting shock settle and refusing to do anything while you're in shock, you just say, I'm just going to sit quietly, just sit here quietly, not do anything at all. I'm not going to do anything mentally. I'm not going to draw any conclusions. I'm not going to make any plans. I'm not going to analyze. I'm not going to imagine this or the scenario, that scenario. Just wow. Everything, all conclusions are just wow. And my back is starting to hurt because I worked out so much today. You block panic and then you feel very calm, very peaceful, calm, and confident. In truth and clarity. You gain more and more confidence and clarity. This is how the Dharma works. And it leads you towards more and more breakthroughs where you see very clearly, oh my gosh, this is all a mental projection. All these so-called needs. I need light to be a world. I need light to be a universe. I need light to be people. I need light to be a world. You know, all this stuff. I don't need anything at all. I'm perfectly free. I don't have needs. How can I have needs? I don't have any needs at all. Doubt is just doubt. It's not caused by anything. So I don't need anything to justify doubt, to play this dance of causation of doubt. There is no causation of doubt except my own choice to doubt. That's all there is to doubt, is our own choice to doubt. When we see this, we realize the world doesn't need to do anything for me. The world doesn't need to be a world. The birds don't need to be birds. Nothing needs to be anything at all. You see this very clearly. And you set everything free. You set everything free. As Jesus said, I loose the world from everything that I thought it was. Okay. I forgive everything. I set it all free. And he says, what you get in return is beautiful beyond any possibility to describe it. And I'm seeing that what Jesus said is true. The Dharma is true. It is true. Doubt, nothing caused us to doubt. Nothing, there's nothing in reality that caused us to doubt. Absolutely nothing whatsoever. It was just a capricious whim on our part. Nothing other than that. And so we have this whole dream scenario of thinking that doubt is caused by in some way. It's not caused by anything. There's no cause for doubt at all in reality. And there's only reality, okay? So this dream of causation, causing doubt, you know, impermanence, death, that's a dream of doubt. We don't need it at all. We don't need it at all. We don't need this dream of impermanence at all. It's just a dream. We don't need it. And you can tell it. Just tell the world, I don't need your world to be a world. You're free. That's what I did last night. Early this morning. I set everything free. I said, you're free. You're free. Everything. You're free. You don't need to be a person for me. You do not need to be a person for me. You don't. You don't need to be a human being for me. You don't need to think you're a body for me. Okay. Nobody needs to be that way for me. I set everybody free. That's the Dharma. That's the Dharma. That's what the Dharma leads you towards. So it's vitally important that this gets transmitted to future generations. So they, you know, they're given the opportunity to go towards realization, realizing this. But it's not, if the Dharma isn't being clearly explained, it becomes very problematic to see this, to recognize it. Inherently, we can all recognize it, but we won't have the skillful means to know how to block panic. We won't understand why we should block it. We won't understand where is this going towards. All of this, I couldn't have done it without the help of the Dharma Kings. You know, I couldn't be where I'm at They were essential for me, essential. Now, if the Dharma gets blocked, of course, a Dharma king can always incarnate in the world and restart it, like Buddha did, for instance, came into the world. They could restart it. But, you know, we it may come to that. You know, it may come to that. But keep in mind that Buddha came in with a bunch of arhats, a bunch of very high spiritual Dharma princes, so to speak, to help him out, get it rolling again, get the Dharma rolling again. He didn't come just by himself. Neither did Jesus come by himself. He came with his apostles, didn't he? So a lot of times when you're really kick-starting the Dharma again in the world, there's a big push that many come into the world at the same time, incarnate, to get the Dharma rolling again. So that may have to take place after what happens here in this world. It may be that we have to kickstart the Dharma again, get it rolling. So I have to, you know, work towards that goal in mind. And if that's called for, then maybe I'll have to be part of that effort to, you know, get it rolling again. Do my little part. You know, and each one of us do our part. You know, we get it rolling again. Because it certainly has collapsed in this world, very badly collapsed. But people are oblivious to that. They think, oh, no, we got wonderful spiritual teaching and teachers now. Everything's great. No, it's not. No, it's not. People are vastly overconfident is what has happened. And the thing is that this is what has happened, like with Dafri John. He played to our overconfidence. He played to this pop culture, this new pop culture, where we became vastly overconfident. And now Trump is playing to people's overconfidence as well, that we don't understand the necessary discipline and difficulty of it and how we have to really, really work at it. And, you know, as Ramaharshi said, steady, steady determination is absolutely required. We're so overconfident, it's ridiculous. We have these teachers going around saying, you know, just come to my seminar, you know, and I'll you know, you're going to be enlightened in a couple of months, or it's so easy, it's so quick for you and stuff. And people are eating this up. They're eating it up. And so Trump is playing to this overconfidence in the world. Technology has made people so overconfident. So overconfident, because technology seems to make everything faster. We can do everything faster, except the one thing it can't do is it cannot make the familiarity problem we have faster. Dissipating the continuity fear, becoming familiar with the Dharma. You have to literally become familiar with the Dharma. The computers can't speed that up for you. That's the one thing they can't do. It's the one thing the technology can't do is deal with help the familiarity problem out. That's what the Dharma does. And it's a very tricky thing to do. It's very tricky. You have to mentally learn to block panic. And you have to be very patient. You have to slow down to speed up, as I say. The Dharma is slowing down to speed up. You have to be very humble. Whereas technology is saying, no, speed everything up. We can do it by speeding everything up. That's the opposite of Dharma. The electronic technology, the science of technology, is really the opposite path of Dharma. It's what blocks Dharma. Dharma it requires great humility, patience, sitting quietly, even though it takes 3 hours of just sitting here doing nothing, blocking calculation, blocking analysis, blocking calculation, giving up worldly ambition, all of this stuff, so that you are willing to just sit and do nothing and allow your shock to settle down. Make no plans, have no ambition at all. Refuse all ambition. Everything concludes as wow, and hold on to that. That's what you have to do. So this whole scientific technological world is very anti-dharmic, extremely so, and it gives rise to drastic overconfidence in every direction. So people are drastically overconfident spiritually right now, and they're easy prey for those who preach just, you know, eat fast food spirituality. Oh yeah, you can get Dzogchen like that, no problem. Yeah, right. Just don't, you know, you don't need to do anything. It's already here. You got it. Okay. Everything. Oh, I got it. Yeah. Okay. Well, they haven't solved the familiarity problem at all. They're ignoring it. They're ignoring it. So Dharmic John played to this severe overconfidence in the world, and people just ate it up because, you know, they said, oh, yeah, this is fast track. Here's God. He's going to give a shakti pot, and bam, you know, we've got it, and that's it. And he played to that. And Trump is playing to the overconfidence of people also, saying, hey, we can really, we're going to fix this world. We're going to fix it right now. And I know exactly what to do. I'm going to do it. And people are suckers for that right now, actually. Where, where Hillary Clinton was just saying that nothing's wrong, everything's great. And then people are suckers for that too. Like, everything's so good, we're already, we're already perfect. Meaning we already know how to be happy with doubt. That was the Clinton thing. Whereas Trump says, no, we're not yet there. We're not happy with doubt at all. We got to fix everything and then we'll be happy with doubt. Different styles, right? And of the same delusion. So people are suckers for this. They're overconfident right now. Way, way overconfident. I've been at the Dharma really since I was 12 for 48 years, and intensely so for 39 years. I'll soon be, if I start well, really, this is maybe the end of my 40th year of doing it, you might say. I'll complete it 40 years after this year's finished. I think that's how I would work it out. And I've been just absolutely working myself virtually almost to death for every day for 48 years, but 40 years super intensely. And I still got a long, long way to go. Okay, long, long way to go. But at least I'm now part of Dharmic culture and part of the transmission of the Dharma as a Dharma prince, part of the actual transmission of Dharmic culture, which is a high position in Dharmic culture. When a Dharma king asks you to help them transmit the Dharma, that's a high position. It's like management, management kind of position. But look what it's taken me. I mean, the amount of effort that I put into it is just, I don't even want to talk about it. I never stop. I never stop. It's 24 hours a day, every day. I never get off of it. And again, I still have a long, long ways to go, actually, the way I look at it. Still very biased against certainty. And so Longchenpa says, yeah, you've made the management grade, but you still got a long ways to go. And he's someone who has perfect discernment. So, I mean, if that's what it takes, the work that I put into it takes, how do these people think that they're going to be enlightened by going to these teachers like that? I mean, come on. They're going to have a concept of enlightenment is what they're going to end up with. And then at some point they realize, whoa, that's not it. Very seductive, though. Very seductive. A lot of people are playing to the overconfidence of the world right now. Guru types and political types and everything. It's the mood of the times is drastic overconfidence. And as we know, pride goes before a fall, meaning falls happen because you're so prideful, you're not paying attention, you're not humble enough to see, hey, we're walking off a cliff here. They say, no, we got it. So my mood is like, I'm going to be working at it for the rest of my life, however long that is here. That's how I look at it. I don't feel I'm going to ease up and say, okay, I don't have to work out anymore. Even if I am in abidance, where I'm free of all doubt, I still will have to work at the residual bias, right? And plus there's a lot of tremendous amount of settling in that needs to take place to help transmit the Dharma even more effectively. And transversing the bhumis to be a Buddha, that's, I see that and I say, wow, that's extremely difficult, So I'm way far away, from being a Buddha, okay? Way far away. And guess what? So are all the rest of us, way far away. So, but the spirit of the times is drastic overconfidence, which is the plan to crash the Dharma, is you get everybody not really working hard enough at it, that ends up, watering it down, and it then is easier to lose sight of it altogether, actually. I mean, the Dharma is all about, steady determination, right? They all tell us that. Ananda Maima, Rama Maharshi, Jesus Christ, Longchamp, you name it. They all say, you know, steady determination. It's really tough. You really have to work at it like it's the most important thing there is. That's the Dharma. Although, if you don't do that, you're not really part of Dharmic society. You're not. You have to get used to the tone of certainty. And that's very difficult because we're so used to doubt that it creates great troubles for us to hear and take to heart the tone of certainty, the certitude of the Dharma Kings, the certitude of the Dharma. It's all about absolute certitude. That's the Dharma's absolute certitude. It just causes us so much anxiety to hear that. So much anxiety, so much difficulty. And it's difficult to get used to it. And so we have to work at it. Like Shankara said, look, if you want to be Dharmic, you just have to take it that you're going to spend your entire life working at it really, really diligently with steady determination. Your whole life. He said, I want you to all look at it that way. So he set up these monastic orders in India, Hinduism, that you were committed for your life, your whole life. You committed to it. That's very Dharmic. That's Dharma. You're committed to it for your whole life. You're committed to it. And that's how it goes. He spoke the truth, Shankara. And in the past, everybody knew that. I mean, if you're not committed to it for your life, you're not Dharmic. What do you think? I'm going to get it so easily. I'm going to, you know, someone's going to hit me and awaken just like that. You know, that's very spiritually romantic, actually. Very much so. Very much so. And, of course, overconfident as we are in this age with science and technology making us drastically overconfident, trying to apply that to the Dharma, thinking, well, computers can solve all our calculation problems in engineering and architecture and structural and run all these, you know, scenarios, plausible scenarios and be able to predict what's going to happen, you know, all the stuff they do, predicting, you know, so much stuff that computers can do with numbers. Well, they think, well, it should be able to solve our spiritual problem the same way. It's a totally different problem. It's a problem of familiarity. We're not familiar with with certainty, the tone of certainty. The only way you get solve that problem is to pay attention to the tone of certainty. But the problem is we put this into shock. So we have to block panic. Otherwise, we'll stall out and we'll fail. Computers cannot do that for us. Computers can't do that for us at all. They have really no role to play in that, actually. People, so many have succeeded in the past. There were no computers back then. You don't need computers to take the spiritual path at all. Now, we can use them just like we can use books. But you don't even need books ultimately. I mean, if you have a guru, that's enough. If you have someone explain to you how to block panic and how to do it properly, then you just sit quietly and you do it. You do it. You don't need technology, science and technology, to be Dharmic at all. It actually gets in the way. It produces overconfidence in us, and we get lazy. We forget how to block panic. We forget that we have to stay on this because the certainty keeps arising more and more, so you got to keep applying your skillful means. And the Dharma means to take us all the way through till we see that doubt is totally uncaused by reality. There's no cause in reality for doubt whatsoever. Zero. You have to see it. You have to experience it. Dharma is all about experiencing. Spiritual path is about experiencing clarity, not having a concept of clarity. Okay, that's the first stage. Okay, that's just the first stage. But entering the stream of the Dharma is you have to start experiencing clarity for yourself within your own, within the mind, actually experiencing it. And that's a whole different ballgame. Then you have to practice skillful means when you start experiencing it. You have to, or you stall out. And then when you fail and then you start blaming the Dharma, then you become very bitter and angry and you start attacking it. So Dharma doesn't want anyone to start who isn't willing to finish. Okay, the Dharma is all about finishing. So when you start out by saying, I'm committed to finishing this. That's how I started out. I said, I'm going to finish it this lifetime. I'm going to finish it. That's it. I said, I'm not going to just, you know, do good this lifetime. No, I am here to finish. Even if it takes my entire life, I'm going to finish. That's the attitude you have to have. You have to have that attitude that you are here to finish. So you don't stall out and fail and then become bitter and start attacking the Dharma and undermining it. Because that's what happens. A little bit of knowledge is a very dangerous thing. You think you've got it conceptually. I got a concept of clarity. And then you stall out, and you get lazy, stall out, and then it doesn't work for you. Then you start saying, hey, wait a minute. You know, there is no God. There is no truth. And you become a bitter yogi. You know, there's a lot of those bitter yogis around who are very hostile now towards the Dharma. But they also seem to be very, you know, clever because they can throw a bunch of verbiage there. You know, they learn the verbiage and the concepts of it. And they've intellectualized it. And now they're telling everyone else, like, that doesn't really work that way. You know, they're very cynical and bitter because they didn't experience it and didn't then realize they have to apply skillful means now because you're experiencing clarity. And you're so desperate, then you do it. You know, it's like, wow, this is the real deal. And then you really become serious about it and have to apply your life and block other stuff. Block your attention from going in other directions. You have to do it. And they didn't do that. So they failed. They stalled out. And they become problematical at that point. They can become snake oil salesmen because they're hip to, you know, they've read all the books, and they can write really well, and they can write books, and they can, you know, make you think that they know what they're talking about really cleverly, but they haven't really experienced it. They're just secondhand. It's hearsay. Dangerous. So we're here to finish. We're here to finish, and we have to finish. Even if it takes us another lifetime, we're not stopping until we finish. Okay, until we're in abidance. That we realize there is no world. That we've set everything free. Nothing's ever not been free, actually. There's only eternal life. There's nothing ever been anything other than eternal life. It's everything is eternal life. And nothing other than that. There's only the perfect freedom of eternal life. And zero cause for doubting this. There's no cause for doubting this whatsoever. Never will be. And abiding in this. Literally. Doing so, literally doing so. As Ramana said, you must not entertain any thought of doubt whatsoever, any belief that doubt is caused in any way whatsoever. You must just stay in this, you know, the jhana state. You must stay in that. That's what he did, perfectly, flawlessly, stupendously. And like, we're like, wow, yeah, that's amazing. It really is for us. We're like, oh my gosh, that's so extraordinary. It's so extraordinary because we keep thinking that maybe this could be a cause of doubt. You know, we're weak, we're weak, and he's so strong, he's perfectly strong. Like, oh my gosh, we have to be like that. We have to be the same. He says, Jesus said, we have to be the same as him. No, you know, don't ever entertain that there could be a cause of doubt in reality. There's no doubt about reality whatsoever. All reality is equally real. It's all real. It's all one reality. It's all flawlessly, perfectly free, right? And we have to abide in that recognition and as that, abide as that. So this takes a lot of effort on our part, steady determination on our part. So brings us back to the theme of our video. Of, okay, what do we do? What do we do? We realize that we, you know, we're faced with a potentially very problematical situation. where we could get really badly burned, really badly burned. I mean, a lot of people want to learn to love Trump. Okay, we want to learn to love him because everything's so screwed up in the world. It is so screwed up. It really is. It's horrible. And he's saying the right things. Like he sees the problems, right? He says, "Yeah, look at this problem. Look at this, this, this." And we say, "Finally, somebody's able to identify the problems." And then he says, "Of course, I'm going to fix them. No problem. I'm going to fix it. No problem. Well, we'll get it done real quickly." And we think, "Oh, thank God, a savior has come." You know, that is good. The same thing as Dafri Jad. He was able to identify our spiritual problems seemingly so accurately. He actually didn't identify them because we were ignorant and we didn't know the difference. But he certainly seemed to talk a good game, a very good game. And everybody said, "Thank God, someone finally is at least talking about all these problems." He basically criticized Christianity a lot and said, "Look at all these problems with Christianity and Jesus and stuff." And we all said, "Oh yeah, we got so many problems with Christianity because Christianity has become subverted so badly throughout thousands of years." And so he was able to, you know, identify a lot of problems that we also saw as problems. But he didn't really know what he was talking about, actually. He didn't. But he was very good at making us think he did. Think he knew what our problems were. Like, so Trump is able to make us think that he knows that he sees what our problems are, and we think, yeah, we have this problem. The problem we have is lack of Dharmic culture. That's our real problem. We don't know, nobody knows how to block panic anymore. That's the real problem we have in the world. That's the only problem. The only problem we have in the world is continuity fear, actually. That's the only problem. It's the only problem. If we didn't have continuity fear, instantly we would realize that we don't have a single there's no problems at all. Problems don't exist at all. There's no problems to solve at all. We would instantly be free from all doubt. Instantly. All of us would be. So continuity fear is the only problem we have. That's it. So Trump doesn't really know what our problems are. Okay. But what our problem is, he doesn't know at all. But if we don't, most people don't also know what our real problem is, and very few spiritual teachers, very few teach what our problem really is. It's continuity fear, and nothing other than that. It's a familiarity problem. That's all it is. That's all that it is. If it weren't for that, then instantly, all regrets and doubts would instantly vanish, as if they never were, without a trace. Without a trace, as Padmasambhava says, one insight settles it all. One, as soon as we see that there's no cause for doubt whatsoever, absolutely no cause whatsoever, and we have, the continuity fear has evaporated, so it allows us to see that totally clearly. All regrets vanish without a trace, as if they never were. That I've experienced that a couple times now. It's absolutely true. It's absolutely true. So continuity fear, the lack of the familiarity, we're so familiar with believing in doubt that certainty freaks us out. We're so used to believing in doubt that certainty, you know, freaks us out. And what just happened to the computer here? It just freaked out. Okay, come back, computer. Don't go away. This is our only problem there is. So who spiritually is telling you this and just this? That's it. That's all there is to it. So just get used to hearing certainty that shocks us, that freaks us out. Block the panic by just letting the shock be there and accepting the shock and saying, okay, I'm functioning. I'll have to function in a suboptimal way for a while. I'm in shock. So let me just cool it, hang out, be quiet. Don't do anything. Don't plan to do anything. And don't make the shock worse. Don't get driving. If you're shocked and you try to do something, then you start panicking. So if you're shocked, recognize and don't do anything. Don't do anything. Don't do anything. Kelly Slater almost died recently in France, world's greatest surfer of all time. He hit his head on his board and blacked out. I think he blacked out. And he miscalculated a turn and he wiped out, hit his head on the board. He blacked out and barely made it to shore. And nobody knew what was going on. He started taking in some water, I believe. He was in a dreamlike state, he said, and he couldn't he couldn't function hardly at all. It's amazing what he has a recent video on YouTube about it. And he said he almost drowned, lost his life. He got to shore, and he said just through fortunate circumstances he was able to get to the beach. But he was lying there in the surf just near the beach, I think. And he realized, I'm in shock. I'm in severe shock. He had the presence of mind to realize he was in severe shock. So this is somebody who has some presence of mind and said, okay, I'm not functioning well. I can't function in this state. I'm in shock. So the very fact that he was very clear that he was in shock helped block the panic. And he didn't try to do too much. He didn't try to do too much. It saved his life, really. So you know, when you're in shock, you can't function very well. And if you try to function very well, you're going to go into panic and then you're going to die. Okay, in that case, if he's trying to surf, if he tried to paddle back out and say, hey, wait a minute, you know, I need to, you know, get back and function, he would have died. He would have died. But he said no. And so he was willing to be non-functional, even though there's a huge crowd watching him. And nobody knew what was wrong. He said, it was so weird, he said. He saw the weirdness of it. He said, so weird, nobody's helping me. Because they think I'm just coming in from surfing and everything's fine. They don't understand. I'm in shock. This is Kelly's own words. But he recognized the situation, but he was willing to be non-functional there in shock and not try to be, you know, Mr. Greatest Surfer of all time, because he realized if I do that, I'm going to die. So kudos to him. It saved his life. Saved his life. It's humility. He, you know, he's kind of has some humility, Kelly Slater. Even though he's the greatest surfer of all time, he's got his head on screwed on pretty straight. He has some humility about it all. He does. I like his attitude. He's got humble swagger. He has humble swagger. And so it saved his life. It saved his life. That he was willing to just be kind of non-functional there, like a idiot, you know, like a total, you know, grabby kook, like a kook, even though there's this big crowd watching him and cheering for him, and he was just able to see the irony and the weirdness of it all, and not let it drive him into panic to try to be, you know, Mr. Hero and say, oh, I got to get over the shock and I got to, no, I'm fine. No, he said, no, I'm not fine. I'm not fine, and I have to accept the fact that I'm not fine. I'm in shock, and I'm on the edge of drowning here. So I'm just going to hang out here and look like a kook, even though the people, you know, even though there's a bunch of people around. You know, brilliant move, saved his life, humble move on his part. So we can learn from that. I saw that. I said, wow, good for you, Kelly Slater. You know, saved your life, and great, because, you know, He's a really good guy in terms of athlete, you know, setting the right tone for athletics. No drugs, humble, no drugs, discipline. He has all these qualities that are very good, that keep him, at age 44, keep him still being, maybe still the best surfer in the world, you know, right up there. At age 44, showing that you can keep functioning really well if you're humble, you don't do drugs, you stay away from these distractions, you be dharmic, in other words, you can keep functioning at an extremely high level even as you get older. That's helpful for people to see that. It inspires them. It inspires them. Somebody surfers like Andy Irons, who got addicted to drugs, you know, and you know, he died basically from it. And he was Kelly Slater's main competition as the best surfer in the world. He was a really great surfer, too. Unfortunately, he didn't have quite the mental makeup to stay away from these troubles that got the best of him, ultimately. Got the best of him. So for a while there, I mean, those two were the greatest rivalry in surf history, was Kelly Slater and Andy Irons from Hawaii. Kelly's from Florida, and Andy Irons is from Hawaii. Was from Hawaii, and they had this amazing rivalry of just pushing each other to be better and better and better and better. But Kelly had his values better lined up, you know. So he's still going really strong. And unfortunately, Andy Irons is in the grave. in the afterlife, actually. Surfing, it can be dangerous. I mean, you can knock yourself out with a board. You absolutely can. That someone else just at Pipeline just a couple days ago. What's his name? Cow or something? Chapman or something? He got knocked unconscious and almost died, and his fellow surfers saved him. And the lifeguards at Pipeline, Hawaiian lifeguards, saved his life. He got knocked unconscious at Pipeline. It's dangerous. If you know, going out alone with nobody else out, that's pretty dangerous. You should go out at least with a buddy or a group of guys, group of surfers. Don't go out alone. It's too dangerous. It really is. Board's hard. You get wiped out. Bam! You hit your temple. You hit your head in the wrong way. You're unconscious. People I know surfing, they all almost died surfing. I almost died surfing a bunch of times, actually. I couldn't get any air. I had bronchitis, I couldn't breathe. I couldn't get any air, and I almost died a bunch of times surfing. It's scary, really scary. Gasping for air, not being able to get air, and you're out in the middle of the ocean. That's not a good scenario. So anyway, long story short, we have to be humble right now, okay? We have to be humble. Maybe we're not functioning in the best way, okay, over the next year. Okay, so I want to set the example of being very humble for the next year. And I may just need to, like, kind of take it easy for the next year, okay? And set the tone. Say, you know what? Maybe we look like a kook. Maybe I'm not going to look so spiritual for the next year. Maybe I'll play golf for the next year, okay? It's by design, because I think everyone's going to be in shock during this next year. Everyone's going to be in shock, and you need to recognize it. And don't try and push yourself too much. Don't try to stand up and say, hey, I'm really, you know, some super dharmic being, and I can, you know, solve all your problems, etc., etc. We may need, you know, I may need to, I'm trying to take kind of a stance, like Kelly had to take a stance there in the ocean, like, I don't know what the heck I'm doing. I'm floundering around in this surf, and why am I not going back out? You know, what is he doing? Well, I got to take this stance. He was willing to take that stance. It saved his life. And the Holy Spirit pointed this out to me. I came across this YouTube video. We may need to take this stance of, you know what? Maybe I'm not, like, you know, some super dharmic being. You know, I'm just, like, kind of hanging out, doing fitness work and playing golf and nutrition and, you know, that kind of thing, which is what I'm doing. I'm trying to set a tone for people, say it's okay when you're in shock, it's okay to be in shock, okay? It's okay to be in shock and realize the weirdness of it. And just let it settle. Just wow it. Just say, wow, this is really cool. I'm in shock. It's weird. I recognize it. Okay? But it looks like I'm going to be okay. Grace of God is saving me. But let me not try to shine too much dharmically during this period. Okay? Very important. Very important message here. So I'm getting into more and more fitness and nutrition. And trying to, maybe I'll hopefully maybe surf or play golf or something. I don't know what I'll do. I hope I can do something like that. I'm kind of more of a surfer guy, getting more into the beach, getting more into, you know, not so much golf right now, but I'm practicing fitness as if I am going to play golf. Instead of trying to come out strong in the world, say, hey, everybody, I'm this Dharma prince, and I know exactly how to solve your problems and stuff. I don't believe that's the right tone right now. Now, if it changes, it changes. I believe the right tone now is to set an example of how to deal with shock, how to block panic. Because I really believe that virtually everyone in the world is going to be in a state of shock in this next year. And how we handle that shock is all important. It's all important. So we're going to, I set this fitness thing. I'm making a quantum leap in my fitness. It's really to just today. I mean, recently I really am discovering how to become more fit to a higher, much higher extent through right core work, right twisting the core, and just I set up some fitness situation here with some more exercises that weren't possible before, and now they're possible, and it's like I'm saying, oh wow. I set this goal of 360, going 360. Was it hitting the golf ball 360 yards? And I'm doing all these fitness to try to, be able to do that. And I've come up with some exercises now just today that are quantum leap actually towards that. I said, oh my gosh, this is going to help tremendously, tremendously. But my core is like really sore. But I also have this heat pad, actually this heat pad, which I heard they're not making them anymore from nature's creation. But I can lie on this and on a bed, and it heats my back up. My whole back gets heated up. You could use like a electric blanket or some heat pad, a large heat pad. And it helps with the soreness of the core. You have to somehow treat the core because it gets quite sore. Treat the core when it gets sore. So I'm treating it with this heat pads, and it's helping a lot. A lot of stretching heat pads. So we may not be talking this real high dharmic level stuff. I mean, blocking, practicing skillfully is the highest Dharma, actually. We don't need to talk about all this esoteric Tibetan Buddhist stuff. Not at all, really. No, we don't. That's for suckers. We need to practice skillfully, blocking panic. That's what we need to do. We need to get really good at that. And I'm pretty good at it. Longchenpa says I'm a near expert at it. Not an expert, but I'm a near expert at how to block panic. Dharma Prince, near expert. But still, I struggle with it. I mean, I realize, wow, I gotta wow this, and I wish I was better at it. Yeah, I wish I was perfect at it. It's you got, it's a grind. You like you're in the fire, man. You got to block that panic, and it's the most important thing in your life. More important than taking your next breath. So I may just be presenting, and people might look and be like, who's this guy? What? Dharma Prince, what are you talking about? He's not saying anything esoteric or like, sounds like some super smart guy who really knows spirituality inside out. He's talking about fitness and golf. What crazy, No, it's really the right tone to set for the times. And the Dharma is about doing the right thing at the right time. It's not showcasing how smart you are. Okay, that's not what it's about. I could do that if that the times call for it, then I could get polish my knowledge and all the verbiage and all this stuff and write a bunch of books and sound like I was super super smart, spiritually smart. Of course I could do that, but that's not what the times call for at all. The way I'm reading the tea leaves, that's not what the times call for. The times call for a humble retreat. As Longchenpa says, to the wild woods, humble retreat and lay low until things settle down, the shock settles down. There's going to be a collective global shock take place. Now, collective global shock, everybody's going to be in shock. So that's the time to consciously, purposely lay low. Like I said, maybe I'll go surfing. Just be a surfer dude for a while. Or supping, maybe I'll go supping, stand up paddling. Possible too, right? That'd be pretty cool. Maybe both. Or maybe golfing also. Kelly Slater's actually a great golfer. Scratch, actually better than scratch. I think he's a plus one. Something. Or is it my, my, he even gives a stroke to scratch or something. He's a really good golfer. He surfs and he golfs. That's pretty nice lifestyle, actually. Yeah, I wouldn't mind that lifestyle. I don't know what his spiritual, practices are, but maybe he has one. I don't know. So maybe I'll just surf and golf. Right? Yeah. I could do that. I could do that. Absolutely, I could. And then, as Ramana said, you know who's really spiritual by the peace you feel around them. So when things settle down, people will be looking for those who really are truly in abidance, not those who are really clever with words. Okay, when you get serious, you don't care how high, the high sounding with words, the concepts. You don't really care about that. You just say, hey, I have to practice skillful means, and they have to work. I need someone who I really can trust. And that has come from peace. You see Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma, the instant I saw her, I said, this is a Dharma King. The instant I saw her, basically in a video, but I saw her walking, and I saw the whole situation around her. I just said, oh my God. It hit me with a force you can't imagine. You know, if you haven't experienced it, it just hit me. I said, this is it. This is a Dharma King. This is total certitude right in this world. And it flipped my expectations to unimaginable extent. All my expectations just shifted at that instant. It was a video. I just watched a video. I rented a video. And I saw her come out of this ashram, walking across this grounds, and it just hit me instantly. I didn't even know who she was. But I knew she knew who she was. She had no doubt in her whatsoever. No doubt. Zero doubt. Zero doubt. And I felt it. I recognized it instantly. And it was just like, boom. I said, This one is going to help me. This one is going to help me greatly. I'm going to go for help to her. Help. Help, 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 help. And she has helped greatly. Helped me move towards skillful means, still skillful practice, getting my attention onto helping me block panic. Same with A Course in Miracles. I came across that and I instantly knew. I said, wow, this is it. This is going to help me greatly. Whoever wrote this has no doubt whatsoever, perfect certainty. And Jesus Christ wrote it, transmitted it. He transmitted it. That was a Dharmic transmission, A Course in Miracles. And Helen Schuckman and William Thetford were Dharmic enough to help transmit it to the rest of us. So thank God for them. Okay. And Ken Wapniak, also Dharmic, helped out. So Jesus was able to transmit this tremendous certitude to us. Thank God for that. So the instant I came across it, it hit me. Also, the Course in Miracles said, oh my God, this is it. This is it. This is what I need. This is going to help me. This is going to help save me from this horrible mental affliction of this dream of conditioned existence, of doubt, this horrible affliction of doubt, right? Longchenpa came to me a dream, woke up the next morning, and suddenly Guru Vision dawned upon me. And I said, oh my gosh, it's because of him. Said he has no doubt. He has no. As I saw him in the dream, I realized he doesn't have any doubt. He has perfect certainty. Oh my gosh! But it was in a dream. This one. Then when I woke up, I actually experienced the condition of no doubt, of awareness of intrinsic spaciousness, of Rigpa. I actually experienced it just from meeting him in a dream. I said, this one is going to help me immensely. And he has, and he has. So that's what we'll be looking for. We'll be looking for that which we just know. They don't have to say anything. They don't really have to say anything. And Anandamaya Ma didn't say a word. I just saw watching a video of her walk, just walking. I said, you don't need to say anything. I said, you don't need to say one word. You're it. Okay, I know you're it. I knew it for sure. There's no doubt in my mind. See, she gave me the experience of no doubt. Just seeing her, I had no doubt. None. Still, just seeing her, I have no doubt. No doubt. I have no doubt that she has no doubt. Okay? She doesn't need to say anything. Brahma Maharshi doesn't need to say anything. I have no doubt that he has no doubt. He doesn't need to say anything, really. So the Dharma Kings, they don't need to say a word, and you know that they have no doubt, and they are going to bring you to no doubt also. they are the means. They are salvation itself, right? They're part of the Dharmic transmission. Absolutely, you know it. So that when you get really desperate, that's what you look for. So I don't need to be running around trying to, you know, show off how smart I am. You know, I don't need to do that. Impressing the gullible, you know, and say, oh, look how smart he is, spiritually smart. He's so spiritually wonderful. Look all the wonderful things he, you know, how brilliant he is, how spiritually, but I don't need to do that. Because that's not what people are going to be looking for once the shock settles and they say, oh my gosh, we're desperate. We are desperate now. This wasn't it. What do we do? Desperate. They want no doubt. They don't need words at that point. They don't need words. Not so much. I mean, you could still use words, but it's beyond words at that point. It's beyond words. So at that point, you know, you don't need any reputation. You don't need reputation. I had no idea who Sri Sri Anandamayi was when I watched that video. I didn't know who she was. But I instantly realized she didn't have any doubt at all. And she was going to be instrumental in my liberation. Just knew it right away. So, no reputation, you know, doesn't matter. You see him and that's it. You know it. So I don't have to go run around, you know, writing books or trying to appear to be brilliant to the world at this point. I don't need to set that tone, okay, for the Dharma Kings. I don't need to set that tone. The tone is just stay in touch with the fact that there are Dharma Kings, okay? Stay in touch with that. But we don't have to be writing about books. We don't have to be writing books. We don't have to be showing off how brilliant we are. That's not the right tone for the times right now. It's not. And so I won't be doing that during the next year. Yeah, as far as I know. As far as I know. I mean, I have an open mind. You never, you know, it's just what is right for the times that we're in is what you do. But I'm willing to lay low. I'm very willing to lay low. And it's likely I will. It's likely I will. And if, you know, that's it. That's enough for this video, right? That's enough for this video. That sets the tone. That sets the tone. You've got the tone now. You've got the marching orders. You've got the tone. That's what's important, the tone. Humble, lay low. Let's not try to be brilliant, okay? Let's not try to show off during this year. Let's err on the side of not showing off, okay? Let's err on that side. So, I mean, you don't see me with long hair and a beard and beads and guru garb and all that kind of stuff, right? I wear like kind of modern golf attire, kind of, right? I mean, I'm very conservative, like a short haircut. I shave. I don't throw around, you know, vulgarity as if that means I'm avant-garde or something. I'm not a bohemian avant-garde type at all. I've very, you know, conservative values, very straight-laced, don't use profanity. You know, I try to be very virtuous and set, you know, that way. I'm not trying to appear to be hip or cool, you know. And I'm willing to live in that kind of lifestyle. And plus, I'm also paying attention to fitness, giving fitness tips, making fitness videos. And say, hey, you know, do this. Just start, use a year to get in shape. It's a way to, it's a focus you could use to keep you from trying to show off, to keep you from being a spiritual show-off. Okay, the tone is, we got to avoid being a spiritual show-off in this year. It's very important. And then nutrition thing. I'm really into the nutrition thing. I mean, it's ridiculous. I got a good laugh out of it. I mean, the smoothies, I drink smoothies. The one I had this morning, last one I made, I mean, it was an awesome smoothie. Totally awesome. I threw in, you know, sunflower seed butter, sesame seed butter, a banana, five leaves of kale, on and on. Goji berries, dried cherries, dried cranberries, blueberries, dried blueberries, just every kind of health thing possible, and apple, fresh squeezed apple juice, fresh squeezed juiced apple juice. I have a juicer, juice apple, apples, juiced apple juice, fresh apple juice, chocolate whey protein powder, and green protein drink with all the spirulina and algae and stuff. That's my food for the day. I mean, it's like, crazy health kind of nut thing, and not over, not actually. I think the people are all freaked out about gluten and all this stuff. They're the health nuts, They can't eat anything that's got this in it. That's gonna kill you. That's the problem, I mean, they go to such extremes. But for me, I'm just trying to like eat, stuff that's like really good for you. It's got antioxidants, okay. No too much greasy food or fried food. I mean, I'm very sattvic in my diet. I don't even eat eggs anymore. I'm like a pretty much a vegan. I eat a little bit of cheese, but I'm really knocked out cheese pretty much, and a little bit of Greek yogurt. But other than the cheese and the yogurt, you'd have to say I'm vegan. I mean, I don't think of myself as vegan. I'm just a vegetarian, but for all intents and purposes, I'm pretty close to that. But vegans can be very strict. Like they search every ingredients, and there can't be any milk product in any ingredient. I no dairy products in any ingredient. I don't do that. I don't go to that extent. I might at some point, I don't know, become a total vegan. It's possible. But very sattvic diet, you might say. Very sattvic, very healthy diet. And I've gradually worked myself into that for the last year. I try to put kale in my smoothies, or mustard greens, or collard greens, or various spinach. I got to start putting. I've got packages of spinach. I think tomorrow I'll have a spinach smoothie. I really will. I really will. That's fun. You can get a nutrition, have fun with that. I've done that the last year, last 16 months. Nutrition and fitness, and I've been able to use that as a focus to try not to show off spiritually too much, and lay low, and get into that. And the way I dress and the way I look and everything is purposefully so I lay low. I don't want to come off as some, spiritual teacher or anything like that. I don't want to give that image out there. I don't want to be tempted, to show off, because there are plenty of activists who want to push you into that role. It suits their purpose, to get people play that overconfidence card, right? It's a really dangerous thing right now. Very dangerous. Very dangerous. That's the last thing you want to do right now, because we have to manage our shock. I have to manage my shock. If I'm up there, if I take a role as some big shot guru or something, spiritual teacher, you're supposed to, you can't be like struggling, You can't be struggling. People say, "What's wrong? I thought you had it all together." And I said, "No, I'm in shock. I'm just like really struggling, I struggle every day." And you can't do that if you're a big shot teacher. You got to show like you're Joe Cool, You're in abundance. I mean, you're in peace. I mean, you don't have these problems. So a lot of these teachers have to hide their problems, and it becomes their undoing. They become mentally unbalanced because they have to pretend they don't, that they never pan, you never, they're never in shock. Yeah, no, this is, they're enlightened. That's a horrible burden to carry, a horrible burden. So we have to avoid that at all costs. And the people would be screaming for gurus right now. Oh, come on, help us be enlightened real fast, because we're kind of feeling jittery, No, you're in shock. And so I'm not in any position where I can take the role of some big shot guru, because I'm in shock too. I'm still dealing with my bias against certainty myself, as is everybody here. I don't think anybody should be coming off as a big shot guru in the world right now. Tell you the truth. Tell you the truth. I really don't know of anyone that I could say for sure should really be coming off as a big shot guru right now in the world. I think it'd be better for everybody to be humble right now and say, you know what? I still have a bias against truth, and I'm still vulnerable to being shocked, and I've got to be very humble and practice full stop in the wow practice myself. I really, this is my, how I see it, is I'm not going to say anyone in the world at this point should you know, avoid this humility right now. Really, really. I know that seems like a drastic thing to say, but I'm saying it. I'm saying it. I mean, my advice is for everyone in the world to take the humble path right now, and don't try to be a spiritual show-off right now. Really, I mean, even the ones that there are a number of gurus in the world that people think that are they're it, right? They're it. And I advise those, the ones who think they're it, I advise them to say, no, I'm not quite it. I still have some bias against certainty, and that could cause me severe problems, and it could cause you severe problems. So I want to back away from being this big show off, and let's take a year sabbatical. There's some good teachers out there, but I think the right thing to do is to take a sabbatical and say, right, set the right tone for everybody else. Set the right tone. Take a step back so you can take so we can all take a leap forward. Take a step back so we can all take a leap forward when the panic, you know, when the shock subsides, settles down, as it will. It always does if you are dharmic about it. Okay, if you're dharmic, if you panic, then obviously you're in a much you're going headed towards psychosis, and we don't want that. We don't want that. Psychosis blocks the dharma, really. I mean, dharma does not transmit wealth through psychosis. Okay, it does not. So take a tip from Kelly Slater, greatest surfer of all time. You know, he was humble and it saved his life. A great teaching lesson. A great teaching lesson. Thank you, Kelly, very much. We all are in your debt for that. You know, that was a very powerful spiritual teaching lesson that we got from that. That the greatest of surfer of all time had enough sense to be humble in a crisis like that. That's awesome. It's awesome. I don't know if the gurus of the world are going to be that humble. I really don't know if they will be. I'm not counting on it. Okay, I'm not going to hold my breath. If they are, God bless. That's wonderful. I encourage them all to be that way. And if they're not, then you know, that it is what it is. It is what it is. If you want some swagger, you know, get in shape. Work on your balance and core and get in shape and hit a golf ball 300 yards or something, you know. I'll be out there on the golf course, you know, saying, "Ah, I just hit one 320, man. That was awesome." But of course, I'm laughing at the whole time, saying, "This is silly, of course. I understand that." But it, you know, it's purposely. I'm purposely dharmically aware, you know, that I'm just sort of channeling my show-offness to hitting a golf ball, you know, 360, you know, yards or something. It's a diversion. It's avoiding the trap of being a spiritual show-off. It's avoiding that trap. So it's skillful means again. Skillful means. See, the Dharma is skillful means. So I'm advocating skillful means right now for everyone, for everyone. And again, I must say, err on the side of caution. Err on the side of caution. We look at the Dharma Kings, like Sri Sri Nandamayi. I mean, just her humility was indescribable. Indescribable. She's so in. So, if you're not that, then you still have some bias against certainty, okay? And who is that? You know, who is Sri Sri Anandamayi in the world right now? Really, seriously. Ask yourself that. The quality that she had was just perfect, okay? And you can feel it. It's a different quality. And so if you don't have that, if you don't have that, then you still have some bias towards certainty, and it's probably better to be humble during this year and to take a step back and say, you know what? Let's all take a step back together, and we still got a ways to go. Even I have a ways to go. You know, so even I have a ways to go. Okay? I'm not quite there yet. I'm not quite there yet. You know, that'll be super helpful for all those who look up to you. It'll be super helpful. Super helpful. And the Dharma will love you for it. Absolutely will love you for it. No question about it. And Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, we will realize more and more how helpful she has been, because she's helped highlight all of this by coming into the world as perfection itself, Dharmic perfection itself. She then enabled us to see, hey, you know, these other gurus nowadays, they're not as maybe as super as they think they are, or as we think they are. They've still got some work to do. She enabled us to see that, because the contrast is there. The contrast is there. If we didn't have that contrast there, it would be quite difficult to see that. And she applied a contrast, female contrast, because there's a lot of female gurus in the world now that I think we would have not been able to contrast them at all. You know, but now, as a female guru, now we can see, hey, wait a minute. Contrast these female gurus with Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, we say, hey, wait a minute. They got some work still to do. Okay? They got some work. So, whoa, wait a minute. You know, let's be humble here. So, she provided that contrast for us. Like, Ramana helped provide a contrast for male gurus, which was super helpful because, for instance, go back to Dhavri John, we had Rama Maharshi as a contrast to him, right? Which was, you know, super helpful for us. Of course, he insisted he was greater than Ramana. Of course, what else is he going to say? But he wasn't. And so we could contrast, say, wait a minute. Something ain't right here, you know. Ramana is perfect. He is, okay? He is Dharmic perfection, Rama Maharshi. And then we looked at Dhavri John and said, wait a minute, buddy, Bubba, you ain't there yet. You ain't there yet. You're just pulling our chain, man. You're just giving us a line, you know. You're showing off. You're a spiritual show-off. That's what he was. He was a spiritual show-off. Dhavri John was a spiritual show-off. Show-off. So was Vivekananda, actually. And so we had Ramana to compare, and that saved us. Thank God. Thank you, Ramana, so much. We could never thank you enough. And we have now, and we have Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, which helps us with the female gurus. Some of them are quite show-offy themselves. And we may have more come down the road who are really big-time show-offs. That's very possible that the biggest spiritual show-off that's going to come in the world that is going to be female. That's very likely, actually. Very, very likely. That the one that's really going to trick us is going to be female. Yet, we have Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, and we can easily contrast them, and just, it's a no-brainer. We say, you aren't Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. Sorry. You know, you got issues still. You have issues. You know, you may be far along, but you still have issues, and you're trying to show off. And that's not the right tone, Dharmic tone, to set right now. I really feel that being a show-off is not the right tone to set right now. I don't care who you are. I mean, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma had times where she'd go silent for like years at a time. Just sit there silently. Not try to do anything. I mean, it was so amazing. You know, the humility she had. And Ramana was silent most of the time, right? God bless them, you know. They're saviors for us. They're really saving grace for us. And we know, hey, we can't touch that right now. They help us see that we have issues. We have major issues. We all have severe bias against certainty. We really do. We really do. And we should never look at it otherwise, that, you know, if we have any bias, it's severe. When you're talking about bias against truth, that's a severe bias. I don't care how, if you just still have a trace, it's still severe. It's still severe. Don't say I have a little bias against truth. There's no such thing as a little bias against truth. There's only a severe bias against truth. So, here we go. Storms coming in California. 3. Boom, boom, boom. Just after the last one, last couple we had, which has left us waterlogged. A friend of mine went back into the backwoods mountain biking, and he said it's just devastated back there. The mudslides everywhere, saturated. It's just wild what's happened back there. And well, we're getting 3 more coming in, so, you know, we'll see how that goes. Right there, you know, it's intense right now. It's intense for everybody, isn't it? So let's play it safe, okay? Let's not follow spiritual show-offs. Let's not pay attention to spiritual show-offs. let's pay attention to those who set the tone of let's take a step back. Let's be humble. Let's take a step back. And let's play it cool. Let's go to the wild woods, as Longchamp advises us. Be very humble. Nobody pays attention to us. That's okay. That's okay. That's fine. That's great. That's great. If nobody wants to listen to a word I say for the next year, that's fine. I'm cool with that. Okay? That's great. And it might come to that. I don't know. But I'm willing that it come to that. That's why I'm fine with that. And then we'll see how it goes after that. We'll see how it goes down the road. I feel this is the right way to play it these times, right way for the Dharma to be played out during these times, during these most critical times, really the most dangerous time in history is the next year. It is the most dangerous time in history, no question about this, because of the modern technology and social media and how attitudes can be spread throughout the world like lightning. And it can snowball, avalanche. I mean, you're talking about mudslides. I'm talking about mudslides everywhere. Well, avalanches, it's interesting. It's a metaphor. Like there could be massive mudslides, spiritual mudslides, attitudinal mudslides everywhere, blocking roads everywhere. Not maybe, there will be. It's all set up that way. There's no question it will be. It doesn't matter what Trump does or doesn't do. It's all set up that way now. The attitudes are already there. The people have been distracted from the Dharma, and they're in panic mode. They have no skills, Dharmic skills at all. No Dharmic skills at all. They're already just, you know, in such a low state of mind, panic state of mind. They think that's good. You know, that's what they're supposed to be. So it's going to be a mess. It's going to be a mess. The next year is going to be a mess. Lay low, lay low, lay low. Okay? Let it play out. Let it play out. And keep your skills, Dharmic skills, strong. Keep your Dharmic skills strong. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. Block the panic. Be aware of the shock. Say, oh, I'm in shock because the tone of certainty, I got hit by it so hard and I experienced it so strongly. Of course, this is going to produce shock. I mean, I can feel it. I need to step in now and say, okay, let's not show off. Don't say anything. Don't try to describe your breakthrough. Don't try to recount it. Don't be a spiritual show off. Be very humble about it and say, right now I'm in shock and I need just to stay in shock and just let it settle down. And that's cool. I'm cool with that. I'm cool with that. I don't want to do anything right now. Let me just be very humble, kind of non-functional for a while and let its shock settle. And then we'll see. We'll go from there. This is the attitude that works. This is the attitude that works. And that's going to be it for this video. I've said enough, right? I've said enough. I've said it. I said what I wanted to say. Set the tone. Set the tone. Set the tone. Wow. 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 And wow this video, because there's been a lot of tone of certainty, very strong tone of certainty in this video, and that's what freaks us out, okay? And we all have this severe bias against certainty. Count on that. It's true. It is absolutely true for all of us. All of us. Me, you, and everybody else in this world. We're all this way, okay? Very great. That's it for this one.